financial, cultural, they lay down the law. They the New World Order is winning, if you like.
They contribute to feeding terror around the world.
Yes.
It's all about terror, right? If you think about the idea of terror, how it affects people's aspirations, people's confidence levels, people's ability to hold down steady relationships.
Yeah.
And you can see that they shot 9 people dead in the north of England 2 months ago. And then another guy went on the rampage, and you know why? Loneliness.
Yeah.
They were afraid of being alone and poor.
Cheer up.
I am afraid of being alone and poor. I do not want to die alone and poor.
Well, that's the feeling. That's the feeling of where people are going. They're heading towards the inevitable.
Do you want to die alone and poor?
Roof said Flaherty, what wonderful day is it?
I would be afraid of that.
Yeah, why is that so terrifying? Why is that
so
terrifying?
Horrible, man, to die alone and poor. Horrible. Like on a street corner with no money, just like, you know, like.
It's kind of debatable.
I don't
want to
die like that.
To understand
you know how I
want to
die? I want to just be by a waterfall in a jungle somewhere, and with all my great.
So does everyone else.
Everybody around, great granddad is sitting by the river, and he's just meditating away, sitting under a tree. And there's a fire there, right? And everyone's tending the fire. Granddad meditates there every night. And one day, Granddad just decides to leave in his meditation, big smile on his face, and he falls over into the waterfall and goes carried off downstream, and they don't have to bother with the body at all. Or he falls into the fire and cremates himself. That's a favourite way of doing it. You just fall asleep and fall into the big fire, and all that's left is your foot or your shoes or something in the morning. Oh, Granddad immolated himself. That's great. We don't have to do any funerals. We don't have to do any shit. That's the kind of way I'd like to die. So I was no trouble to anyone. If I
happen to
be a big
player on a boat,
if I happen to die in any situation that I'm not actually aware of, I'm going to do. I'd like my body to be taken in a big hole under an oak tree. Put my body in there.
You have to get cremated. You can't be buried. Asshole. The one, and that's why I wanted to be buried.
You
got
to be cremated first.
You can't be buried.
Wait, so bad. So I had to make.
I mean, the one fucking thing I thought I would always get away with is being buried at sea.
It's last on the leg to tell. That's it. And the night before, I opened the door. He asked to go outside. I opened the door. He went outside, and he didn't ever come back. And I never ever found him anywhere.
No.
So that's pretty.
That
that's
cool. That took all of your stress out of everything.
And we came to take him to the vet.
The Eskimo women, or Eskimos, when they reach, they know
that's someone's cat stuff.
Well, no, they're no longer contributing. They're no longer bringing food in or doing anything. It's dysfunctional. Then they go walk.
The biggest cat I've ever seen.
Open the door and walk out into the ice.
They wear them around my collar or around my neck like a little scarf. I get in
I
the bucket
they
and
find
swing them round as fast as
the morning,
can.
You can just pick up
bucket
easily,
and
bring it around.
About. And everything I do, I'd throw them over the washing line to see if it land on its feet.
But they can't burn them.
They still come back to me. Well, I saved them on the roof one time.
That's the polar bears.
Panicked and jumped up and scrabbed it. I got lines down my back where you can explore them.
No.
But I'm going
to get a husky. Have you seen a husky dog?
A polar bear.
I saw one the other day. And we're going to get
polar bear.
It's all over the
place.
Yeah, never appreciate it. They never appreciate it. Unless they want something.
I want 2 parrots, right? I want 2 golden macaws.
I have a cat and a dog.
Polar bear's sense of smell is so highly developed that you can see over the horizon through a heat image. They say they got heat sensors in the
brain.
That's
20 miles.
They got heat sensors in the brain, which means that they can see over the covert of the earth and see the warmth of something as small as a seal. Given up the source of heat energy and their smell and their vision.
Over 20 miles away.
Yeah.
Because the horizon is 20 miles. It starts bending after
on
20
flat.
Miles.
On flat. On depends flat. Where you are on the earth.
No, on a flat.
Yeah.
Absolutely flat. It's 20 miles and it starts bending away out of the flat. So that's a long way to smell something. Mm. And do you know that a moth about that big can smell a male moth up to half a mile away of that big? Yeah. And how many scent pheromone particles can that male moth actually send out for this little tiny body? Yeah. Not very many.
Exactly.
So half a mile away the moth is smelling that and can guide to the male moth. Fantastic, isn't it? Nature is so fantastic. So fantastic. They found living cells, what they call nanobacteria, in pure sulfuric acid bath, 5 kilometers down in the earth, through the earth's crust. They come to pure sulfuric acid bath.
Right.
And in there is nanobacteria living, living organism. Fucking hell. Nanobacteria are very interesting. They've been discovered in rock that's come from Mars. You know, meteorites landed in the Arctic, and they found these, Bill Clinton.
You're alive.
They found a meteor that had what looked like bacteria in
your comedians at the side.
So life is not confined to this.
I'm
going to
show guys down the
everything you see there is a galaxy.
We're in Iraq.
You won't see a single star because they're all too far away.
Fucking TV in Iraq.
Shine close. Those are all galaxies.
And when you think
that's the Milky Way.
When you should think about how big a galaxy.
And each of those galaxies got 100 billion stars in it.
Two guys in Sesame Street in the bathroom.
That's Jupiter.
No. That's all the time. Those two. No.
The thing is,
at
the
end of
Sesame
Street. Oh, the Muppet Show. Sorry. The end of Muppet Show. Remember.
It kind of.
And the children be sitting up in the bathroom, looking down on the stage. The Colonel, the Miss Piggy, and all of them.
Bubble syndrome.
And remember, they always had an asshole attitude. That's what I was talking about.
Well, let's do it then. Within the Hubble telescope.
Not bubble syndrome, is it?
Because you kind of ran off in those general directions.
Hubble telescope.
Oh,
hey,
I've got my message. Go back to that.
Don't get bipolar on me.
I just want to hear that. That's an interesting conversation.
I think that's gone.
The Zeitgeist will talk about that.
A Zeitgeist movie. The movie?
No, the movement.
Or the
movement.
The movement.
Subscribe to this site. And
I have been reading stuff.
And since I've subscribed to this site, it kind of opens doors to your perception that you didn't know existed.
Right.
You know what I mean? Sure. Back doors, side doors.
Right.
The ways Matrix. Into history.
The Matrix.
Everything.
Okay.
But there's a thing called bubble syndrome, whereby people have an understanding of our global position in the universe.
Hello, camera.
Oh, I mean,
need to pull it forward a wee bit. I think there's a clicky thing on it. I think it's not focused on me yet. You're aiming up towards the roof, I think.
News.
So.
This is the idiot.
Yeah, I just missed all that. Can you do it again?
All right, cut.
Round two.
Ding. Right, I'll talk to you about bubble syndrome. Have you seen yourself in the mirror recently?
Yeah. Piss you off more.
I'm gonna get fucking cross-eyed.
I don't know.
That's all right. That's all right.
You gotta get it right.
You know what? I love the fact that this is unplanned. We didn't plan to come here, and now that we're here, I realise that this whole trip has a very specific purpose.
Definitely.
40,000.
Yeah.
I've enjoyed your time.
The story over and over and over.
Things can change, Ray. Things have to change. Things are changing, whether you like it or not.
Do you like that?
Yeah, I can end you with that.
Yeah. Videos.
Right, looks like a stubbed off feather. Black USB stick.
Oh, I am the shaman original lizard king. I am the lizard king.
Yeah, man, we could do a follow-on from the one we posted last year.
No, Steve is the lizard kin. Steve looks more like Jim Morrison. If Jim Morrison was 44, he would look like Steve.
They're the same kind of thing. They do look a bit alike, alright.
If Steve broke out into song like Riders in the Storm and he did a perfect take off of Jim Morrison, I reckon he could get away with it. Eddie could get away with it if he could pull it off.
It used to be when the film came out, I was getting lots of shag. My friend really into me lately.
Yeah.
I love that song. Layer it on, then fucking break me down and spit me out at the end of it. Done left with gristle.
No, no, I'm going to put you to
Right, that's it, I'm going back. Get the timeline, go right back, cut it off before she gets a chance to do that. Be innocent again.
No, if you had a tattoo, this is the thing, if you had a tattoo with your ex-girlfriend's name in it, that would be more sad. Because then you'd all be constantly reminded every day of what a fucking sucker you were.
The funny thing is, the last two birds I've been in love with, one was called Emma Noble, and there was a model called Emma Noble, so I couldn't Google her to see what she was about, because there was nothing there. And the other one was called Sharon Clinton. When I left the job, Clinton got together with Sharon in Israel, so I couldn't look up her on the internet either.
There's fucking bar everywhere.
What's happening? It's chaos theory. Why do I always attract the fucking...
Well, at least you know that Sharon met with Yasser Arafat and shook hands with Bill Clinton in the middle.
But where's my fodder? Where's my grub?
Do you want to see some stuff from the Hubble telescope?
Yeah.
I'm just buffering. This is called a tour of the universe.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, I've seen
like
this.
Is it good?
I got that one. Of work. The Big Dipper.
The what?
The Big Dipper there.
It shows you
stellar
the
death and planetary birth, the beginning of time and the end of the universe. As it enters its 15th year in orbit, NASA's Hubble Space Telescope continues to be the most productive space science mission in history, showing us the wonders of the cosmos like no other telescope ever has. Stars die in one of two ways. They slip gently into the night, or they go out in terrific blasts. When stars die quietly, they often create majestic sculptures of gas and dust to mark their graves. For centuries, astronomers studied these nebulae, thinking them to be simple bubbles of gas. But Hubble observations have revealed structures of surprising complexity. Why? One such nebula is the Halley.
What we expected was something much like my glasses here, where we'd have a rim, and then we'd have a disc of material like the glass lens they had. And then what was interesting to us was that the glass would be tipped with respect to the rim. So in the Helix Nebula, the disk is tipped with respect to this ring.
The complex double ring structure of the helix is baffling, inspiring new questions about how stars die. For more than a year, Hubble has been observing a peculiar star in an obscure constellation. That star flared up once and became briefly the brightest star in the Milky Way galaxy. Hubble sees the star's light echoing off of gas and dust clouds lurking in the space surrounding it. On October 9th, 1604, something flared up in the western sky. Astronomer Johannes Kepler observed the event, which he called a nova, or new star. The telescope had not yet been invented, so sky watchers could only observe the exploding star with their naked eyes. Modern astronomers have an array of powerful space telescopes, including the Spitzer Space Telescope, the Chandra X-ray Observatory, and Hubble to watch the heavens. These great observatories are surveying what's left of Kepler's supernova in infrared, X-ray light, and visible light.
Objects like supernova remnants are, by their nature, multi-wavelength objects. They emit over radio waves all the way to X-rays, all different kinds of light. So to really understand them, we have to look at them with different tools, different telescopes, that allow us to see that different kind of light and understand different components of the system. So for instance, Spitzer's
I've got an interesting one. This one.
The Chandra telescope really sees the hottest component of the gas, low density gas, but very hot gas. And Hubble sees the denser component of the interaction of the blast wave with the surrounding interstellar medium.
Stellar explosions are incredibly destructive, but they also see the universe with elements like carbon and iron that eventually form planets and even people like ourselves. Hubble and its sister telescopes show us how...
Oh, in there if you want, yeah. That's it. And then hit delete.
The end, I just finished college here. The end of the show. I called my piece Crim of the Crop. Instead of Cream of the Crop. He didn't want me back.
What are you putting on, Gary?
I don't know.
Find Roy Gallagher, will you? Will you Google him and just play one of his songs, just for magic, so he can be like a great musician.
Come on, Sting, everything you do is magic.
No, don't worry.
Every little thing you do. CD in the side and press play.
Yeah,
okay. We travel 10 times farther from Venice, and our view of the universe.
What's this? This
I'm not going to learn anything from it, Terry. I'll look it up later. You know, put some music on.
No, this has got music on it.
I don't care. The known universe. I'm not here for fucking history that I can do any time.
I have to actually back them up.
Shut up.
Put the fucking CD in the side of it.
Shh.
I told you Google Roy Gallagher for God's sake, so imagine.
Is that what you mean?
Oh, no.
I love a bit of Dylan in this surrounding. It's good rebel music. It's fucking solid.
Shut up.
Terry, this is you?
Yeah.
Oh, please.
Yeah?
Please.
Yeah, we'll get
at some point.
Yeah. Have a look at this. Look, this is what I wanted to show you.
Okay. Is this the Mahavishnu?
This is the known universe.
We're going away from Earth.
You're going away from Earth now. You're pulling out from the Earth.
What part of the Earth is that?
That's Tibet.
Tibet. Can you see this, guys? See it, Raymond?
Yeah, you're fine.
We're going away from the Earth. We're going past the sun. across the planets.
And beyond the outer scale of the universe.
I'd love to see that, man, from space.
Them's all the satellites around it. 250 satellites.
Is that all?
I think that's
nothing. I thought it was many more than that. And space debris of all sorts.
Yeah, there must be a lot of shit.
Interfering.
Wow. Yeah, interfering with all the all the natural forces.
Yeah, it's fucking up the weather and everything.
Is it?
What's that white light? Is that the magnetic pole? Is it? Or is that something else? That white light.
Elliptic, it looks like.
No, they're the space stations and the
Okay. Here we go. Beyond the solar system. That's the moon's orbit. We're going further out now, right?
This is the orbit of the planets around the sun.
Right. We're going out past the Mars.
Uranus.
Saturn. Neptune.
Uranus. They couldn't think of what else to call it.
That's 1 light year away.
That's, yeah, one it diminishes light to nothing, I'm sure. Yeah, there
takes,
it goes.
If it takes a year for light to get there, I think
it's just disappeared into
light
nothing.
Light travel, okay,
Extension.
100 billion miles.
That's the Milky Way. That's our galaxy. Away from our galaxy. The galaxy is nearby. Oh, we're going a long way on.
And right now.
Galaxy's 100 million years.
How many stars can you see in the sky at night when it's clear?
What?
How many stars?
Well, it looks like.
That's what we're looking at.
It's like the impression.
That's the view. We have. We haven't been there.
Listen to this.
No.
You look up, walk out the door, look up in the sky at night. How many stars do you think you count?
Probably none on a cloudy night.
How many stars do you think you can see?
Left that planet 100 light years away.
Yeah, exactly. You're going back into ancient history when you're looking.
But you can't. You
how many stars do you think? 2,000 then. Some people can't. That's all you can actually see. It all seems bigger. It's only 2,000. It's a mathematical device because the NASA came out with it.
That is our universe, that's the ultimate bubble.
Well, one of the what's outside that?
Yeah, now how much life
but
is
what's
there?
Outside that?
There could be as much life in that bubble as there is on the planet Earth.
Parallel universes, alternate.
But it's so far apart.
Things, everything, alternate universes or something.
Reconnect.
I don't know.
I forgot the camera going. I was. This is the Bible. I thought you were getting angry.
They're moving away from the
camera.
Everything's moving away from
the speed of light.
No, it's not the speed of light. We go around the solar system.
Oh, in front of the camera. Like.
Everything is relative to the size of the object.
Beavis and Butthead.
Sorry, you got that. So now we're going back to the Earth again.
I'm saying the pull of the gravity of the sun is as relative to the size of the sun as it is to the universe.
Where's that?
What about the moon? It's around somewhere.
Is it?
Could be up there, actually.
I want to show you.
It's
fantastic.
I haven't started reading it yet.
No, just recommend it, and I'll go out to my local library and pick it up.
Is it on top of it?
Yeah, here it is. It's a fantastic book. Well researched, well put together. Very interesting.
Yeah.
About the coincidences and the distances and the sizes of the moon in relation. Exactly.
desert of rocks.
Yeah. Well, it may not just be us. There may be many, many like that. There may be many planets. Can't prove it. Oh no, but we're getting close. And not to proving it, but getting close to... We've already proved that there are many stars with planets.
Until you can prove it, God will always...
God. Leave the God out of it. God does not exist, alright? God
is of millions and billions of things.
Yeah, but that doesn't make it exist.
A higher level
it
of
existence. It makes it a very big problem, though.
A higher level of existence does exist. It doesn't have to be
Listen,
God. It's just the next level of perception.
Atheist.
Right? Why we're here?
Well, with the agnostic tendencies, we say that I don't actually know anything. I only don't believe what I don't know.
But we couldn't have this conversation. We couldn't have this conversation. Without thinking, arousing the suspicion of the people.
Oh, they kill you. Have you seen the fatwa thing about the Muslim religion? Have you seen the fatwa? This guy was killed. He was called, what was his name? He was a Dutch filmmaker, Geert Wilders.
Oh, right.
And he made this film about the Quran, where he took the verses of the Quran and he took film with Arabic women and how they were, you know, how the suppression of Arabic women and beating and murdering Arabic women. And he was killed in about 2 years ago in the street in Amsterdam. This Muslim ran up to him and put a knife in his chest and put a, and then took it out and put this piece of paper which
on
said, Allah, God is great. Death to infidels on this piece of paper
and
stuck the knife back
knife.
In his chest, man. Killed him stone dead. Kurt Wilders, it's called. I'll just show you.
I know. And that other guy, the relative of Van Gogh.
Oh, yes, Vincent. He was actually.
Yeah, Vincent Van Gogh.
Yeah.
Is
there any other Van Goghs?
Vincent.
Apart from his family, like his direct brother and shit and all out there,
Vincent.
Whatever, but.
Well, they're a big line of Van Gogh.
Yeah, I never heard anybody ever called Van Gogh, apart from his family.
His brother was an architect, though.
Yeah.
His brother was an artist.
Architect, then.
What? No, his brother was his agent.
Oh.
His brother was his agent, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He managed all his career, otherwise he wouldn't have had the money to
he
go out.
He didn't have
make.
Any money. His brother had to give him money all the time, for God's sake.
That's what
broke.
I'm saying. He was his agent.
He was in a mental hospital when he did his
best.
But he
didn't even sell anything, for God's sake, at that time.
Not while he was alive, but once he died, he sold a few, you know.
Protected, like?
Yeah, and he needed to sell one. One of his paintings is worth something like $5 billion.
Yeah, I don't really want to sell any of my originals.
What?
I wouldn't sell
about
any originals.
About 28 or 9. About 128 million.
No, you're talking serious money for a Van Gogh
about
original...
Look,
one
yes,
the
about
ones,
150
the
billion.
Stupid money.
Something.
Stupid
yeah, really. Well, money. Why not? He only painted a few, right?
Stupid, crazy money.
Yeah, well, there's no point in selling out. I'm going to get what I want for my fucking artworks, the originals. Only sell prints, you know.
It makes more profitable sense, though, for the Van Gogh family to
and
rent...
make sure that he signs all his paintings when he gives them to you, because one day when
they
he's
can,
dead...
They can rent him.
They could be worth over 100 quid.
Well, 150 quid more, like. My life worth. What's it worth? Nothing. They didn't put a copyright on it.
No, when they move a Van Gogh painting, it has to be escorted militarily. It's worth so much.
Hey, listen to this, guys. This is just the first one. This is what he got killed for.
This film
got killed for this.
On the basis that copyright was owned by the artist, never by the label. When they folded, nobody could buy it. They were given like an office of 5 million and shit. But there's no assets, there was no bond or anything that it was, they had a holdover on the contract. It was a free contract to walk whenever they wanted.
Surah 8:6.
Across the road from their main, when they first made their headquarters, was later turned into a...
Prepare for
the
equivalent of force and cavalry you are able
to
hold down.
Have a good laugh in Manchester.
We've
got
to
be doing
to strike terror into the hearts of the enemy.
We've been working
hard
for
4 years.
I've never been to Manchester.
This is Mohammed, the great bringer of peace.
I haven't been to Liverpool either. You were checking out.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I've only been through Liverpool, never really stayed there now.
Yeah, this is inaccurate.
Yeah, I see that thing on the thing, okay, there, mate.
Yeah, it was the biggest fireworks, the most expensive and elaborate fireworks display that we've ever seen. Did you manage to make a split?
Yeah, man.
Look, haven't we got a nice big fucking pile of jokes to smoke? You have a split, man.
I was going to make another one, like that was a big party to get you all happy, like, loads of figures I could make.
Careful with yourself, man. Be careful, man.
About what?
About your foot. Look at that, man. Wait. You've got to take care of that, man. We need you. With both legs.
What can I say? It was a very, very powerful thing that happened to me. I was about to leave where she was living, and we were putting a teepee up. And I was carrying two teepee poles, and I was having a brilliant time.
And you put your foot down a pothole.
Exactly. And halfway down the pole there was a stone sticking out and it cut my ankle in half.
Ooh.
Right down to the bone. And if I hadn't had that cut, I would have gone on the airplane the next day. And as it was, I couldn't move and I stayed another 2 weeks. And when I said another 2 weeks, she could come down here for 3 weeks. So we've been together instead of just me having to leave and come back here and deal with all my stuff on my own. It was just amazing, wasn't it? If that hadn't happened, we wouldn't be here today like we are. I don't think.
Okay, you've seen the positive side of it. But barefoot shaman shouldn't be walking with fucking heavy shit on their fucking back.
Those who have disbelieved our signs, we will roast them in fire. Wherever their skins are put to a turn, we shall substitute new skins for them. And they shall, and they will feel the punishment. Verily, Allah has said it. This is a fucking written by Muhammad. This is written in their fucking Bible. The Muslim Quran.
Can you see
they
any,
worship.
Can you see any F-15?
You can't say a word against the Quran or they'll kill you.
Listen, there's no F-15s there. There's no nuclear submarines. There's no tactical missiles of any description. It's air they're transmitting. And this is the fear factor. I'm not afraid of that. They've got weapons of mass destruction. They can't even defend themselves.
No, it's hyped up. But I'm not talking about the
terror. You can't go to battle with
swords. I'm not talking about the terrorist aspect of Muslim. I'm talking about the misogynistic, woman-hating stuff, which
that.
Is nothing to do and with the terrorism.
And you showed us what the Catholic Bible said before, the medieval Catholic Bible, which they still abide by today. The same thing.
Mm.
They're crazy. Mm. Both, mm. all, mm. two evils don't make
no,
a right.
No way. This is
But it's despair. You can hear despair in the voices and the attitudes of the people. People become desperate because that's why they're doing these things and feeling this sort of way. They've got nowhere to go.
God bless Hitler. That's Muslims carrying their banner.
They've got nowhere to go. The Germans felt they didn't have a choice either.
I have the same Bhakti-ism. Every tragedy, Hitler and me.
Here's the next Quran.
Not the same here, but the same person.
Don't go telling people that.
I hate the bastard, actually.
Therefore, when you meet the unbelievers,
you Aries as well, yeah.
Right at their necks.
Yeah,
every 20th.
I'm 15.
Oh, yeah.
You have killed them. It's the same as their own honor, Allah, or something. I can't even
forestell it. Same as Sam Fox, it's all on the same day as Sam Fox. I think so. Maybe she's a year older, but the same day, the year, I don't know, I can't remember the year.
Multiplicate that
Without Iranian oil, the Chinese would still hold the dominance over the world.
The Chinese are because the Americans are boycotting.
An industry cannot function without an oil man.
It's the lifeblood of the industrial system.
They don't. This is just a symptom. Now look at the cause. We know this exists. It's shameful.
It's shameful that such a large group of people are flourishing. But they but wish that ye shall reject grace, and as they do, and thus by the same footing as they, so take not friends from their ranks until they flee in the way they are. But if they turn renegades, seize them and kill them wherever you find them, and take no friends or helpers from their ranks.
I'm gonna take out a jihad on your ass.
Then it's so much. You can show me Shabbat. It's so much.
No, you're more fucked if you've got a fatwa. Jihad's alright, we can nuke him.
I'm wearing a fucking, what do you call it? Genocide form. Sam Tech. Cheese Tech.
But these are biblical apocalyptic times we're living in.
Yeah, fuck them, we need to chill out.
We need to chill out. Everybody's going the same way. No one's separate from what's going on there. It's just a different form of anxiety. It's a channeled anxiety into a single cause.
Fucking shit. Yeah, it's all bollocks, man. It's all a joke. It's fucking people making the news because that's what they want to happen.
There's no difference between that and watching the Jerry Springer show. The same fucking thing.
What we want to happen now? Fucking keep them occupied. Things could be worse. Don't fucking think about Africa and shit. Everybody's happy. Start spending. Start taking more fucking credit on. Fucking people start making money off your money by lending you money.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking usury. It's a Jewish thing. It's not Christian.
All right.
You can't, bro.
Let's see the Israeli version of this. Because I think that's what we're watching. You have to balance it out. You have to show both sides. John Pilger done a good documentary about that.
The Dutch are fighting back. That's why the Dutch are voting all of this stuff, because they don't want. The Dutch have a very close relationship with the Muslim world because they've conquered Africa in a big time. You know?
Yeah, so, right.
And so they have a lot of refugees coming from Algeria.
I didn't know that.
the Netherlands is under the spell of Islam. Anyway, he got killed for this. He got killed for that film. For making that film, he was killed.
Mosque will be part of the system of the government.
The thing is, when you see something that's visibly distorted by the rationale of a person who cannot be objective, he's part of that.
Who are you talking about?
The filmmaker.
Jimi Hendrix, is he, or is he not experienced?
The filmmaker is trying to be objective, but he's. His heart and his passion is too intertwined with the culture. So in a way, he's a traitor to his own faith.
No.
And he's killing himself by making the
film.
No,
all he's done, man.
It's another form of
martyrdom.
It's another form of martyrdom.
You drunk all that vodka, you guys?
No, not me. Still about.
There's a jug of it there behind you.
No.
I haven't had any of it.
It's behind you.
It's like being on stage and like in a comedy one. guy just come back behind with a big axe or something. It's behind you.
Panto.
No, seriously, guys, did you craft that whole bottle?
No, it's behind you. there's a big jug of it there, and there's a plastic bottle.
Oh, okay, no, I just saw an empty bottle of vodka, man. I thought, how fucking hell could you guys still be standing up?
No, it's all yours.
I'm sitting down, I mean, you'd be lying.
Because do you know what?
Anyway, I'm going to play you this one guy, man.
Magic, can I just say something here?
While I'm doing my stuff.
Because you, coming here, right, we didn't know, I couldn't really figure out why I came to Ireland this year, because we had some loose arrangement that we were going to go touring the road, but it never works out according to plan. Does anything work out according to plan? But now that we're here, the plan has come together.
You know why you're here.
Exactly, I know where we're going.
Why you're here is for a rejig.
Yeah,
exactly. Right, and a boost. And you come here to boost me, and you come here to get boosted. So we get boosted in our ideas, we get boosted in the way we're living, who we, you know, what's good, what's going on. We data drop. Which is like, I've got a whole lot of data in my head that's updated since the last time I saw you. Yeah. And if I could possibly just plug in a thing in there and just go, and then plug it in your ear and go, you've got all my updated data on all sorts of shit,
right? Magic.
And you do the same for me. I get all your updated data.
Can I just say something? I'll give you that camera and tell you how to use it. If you give me a bag of cans, if you could do it.
You will what?
I will give you that camera that Terry's wearing. So
which camera is
on
that?
On Terry's head.
Look, this camera.
It's a camera.
Yeah.
Are you recording now?
Yeah, all of it, yeah. The past half hour.
Or so. You should have told me, man. It's got no flashing red light.
Left
it's
should
a
be green.
Secret or rocking camera.
At the top of it, it should be red or green. I can't remember. Maybe it's not working.
It's not.
I don't know.
I'm not starting to play the camera if the camera's not fucking working, man. I'm not going to do my actor thing.
Well, have you seen one of these before?
Sit with me, we're on camera. Right. We're on camera.
It's on green now.
Right, now it's recording. So, please ask me a question about anything that's bothering anybody. Not just you, but like, what's bothering you? Anything bothering you?
I'm feeling really happy, man. You're fucking
right now, me. You're okay. What about you? Any questions?
Yeah, I've got plenty of questions.
Right, okay, give us one. Start me off.
If you fall in love and you fall really hard, how do you get back up again and stay up?
Well, for a start, falling in love down on a hard place doesn't sound too nice to me.
That's why they call it falling.
Well, exactly.
Because it burns like a ring of fire.
Right. So you take falling and you translate. The next time I meet a woman that I feel that falling in love for, I actually... I'm raised in love.
Alright, that's good. That's better.
Instead of falling, you're raised.
One of those
right?
DVDs.
And what do you meet up there? But you meet angels.
Put music, one of them. Put on, what do you call them?
You meet higher quality beings that are going to support you in being totally who you are. If you fall in love.
If I make a promise to someone, and I know I can't deliver it, I'll fall.
So don't make promises you can't keep. It's simple,
I can't
isn't
help
it?
It. I can't stop.
Oh man, that was a big one in my last relationship. I made promises that I couldn't keep. Therefore, I was accused of being a liar, which is fair enough, I suppose, in a roundabout way. I lied by saying I wasn't going to see somebody when I did see them. Mm-hmm. But at the time I said it, I wasn't lying because I actually meant it. The fact that I saw them was because they were basically suicidal, and they called me up and they said, come and see me because I'm suicidal. So I went to see them and I'm suicidal. I thought, I better not tell her. So I didn't tell her, and then she found out. So basically,
and she thought shit was going on when it wasn't.
Yeah, it was complete crap, but I didn't dare tell her because I thought, you know, if I tell her I've gone to meet this person, she'll freak out anyway. So which is the worst of the freaking out? Either you tell the person they freak out, or you don't tell them and hope they don't freak out. So I didn't tell.
That's a different
became a liar. Then I became distrustful. So she couldn't trust me. And when she couldn't trust me, she couldn't be with me. And I think it's a load of bullshit, actually. But
can you ever read...
You would trust me. I wouldn't do that. I know, I know. That's my big lesson.
Do you believe in redemption?
I learned that lesson.
Yeah. Do you believe in redemption? Do you believe in karma?
Believe in... Now you've got me. This word belief is something I don't like. I never like beliefs. Just because they're not scientific. A belief is something somebody's told you, or it's an idea or a fantasy that you have that you put weight behind, and you say, yeah, that sounds good, like reincarnation or like life after death or any of these belief systems.
Turn belief into mechanics, right? When you're driving in your car, yeah, and you're going forward, you believe that round the corner there isn't a tractor which is on your side of the road.
Usually turn to religion.
That's intuition.
That's a basic. Perhaps you hope there's not.
Yeah, which is a form of belief. So it's a basic assumption that one can assume and put to the side. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you must be justice.
That is a trust in a law-abiding, third-dimensional motorway system. When you get in a car, you obey the laws. Everybody obeys the laws unless they're drunk.
It happens all the time in Ireland. People come round corners and they crash into it.
They're drunk. Or they're foreigners, they come around the corner on the wrong side because they're Germans, and they've gone off somewhere, and they go on the side of the road they're always driving on.
Having a laugh with their mates, not even concentrating,
So Germans particularly, and French, they do have head-on collisions in Ireland, because they come over and rent a car from Dublin Airport, Cork Airport, they're fine for the first 5 miles, and then they start talking to the missus, and they go over onto the wrong side of the road, and they've lost it, you know.
You gotta go fast. Yeah, Terry's got that attitude.
That's happened a lot.
When he can go faster, he goes too fast, man, because the van ain't gonna go over 65 unless it's burning juice. I mean, a massive sort of like, I didn't say anything to him, but he was looking at me, I said, Terry, not over 65, and he'd always nudge it up to 70, like, and then I'd look at him and go, fuck.
He had some beers. Is that on?
Yeah, I think so. This one's on anyway.
We got that one.
Yeah.
We got a bit of that.
The fundamentals of belief are that you can make a basic assumption about something and let go of it, which frees up energy in your brain to not be paranoid about every single relationship or every single misgiving that you might have. You know what I mean? That's all belief is. It's not about religion, it's about a connection to the spirit that you're going to be okay when you go to the shops.
Wait a minute, let's get
a bit more technical here. Belief, as defined by Webster's dictionary, would be taking on an understanding that you have been given.
That's a belief system. That's a different thing. A belief doesn't have to be part of a system. It can be a personal, integrated belief.
Give me an example.
Love is the love and the trust that two people have between each other is the only single belief that people who stay together have.
And when you show people how you know that, it's a known fact.
Yeah, you feel it.
Once you get married, then you've had it systemized and it becomes a belief system. That's why marriages fail, because it's like, I don't want to be a part of this institution of marriage anymore because it's crippling me emotionally and I want to get out.
Yeah, Terry,
are you in a marriage right now?
Terry, before we go any further, sorry, Magic. Terry has been, he's on a retreat with me, we're sort of chilling out together. We don't need to go through what happened, Terry, because this is on film, number one, and we've already gone through it, so, you know.
Now, something significant happened.
Yeah.
Well, share it with us.
It's too close to it.
I just opened the door for a couple of minutes.
Yeah, do. So share it with us if you like, man.
It's just
you've got to go outside here.
I had an internet relationship with my friends.
No names.
My friend.
No names. I don't need them.
With a very good friend of mine, his daughter, who he hadn't seen in 20 odd years. She's 23 now. She came over, and it was instant sort of magnetism,
I know that.
And then I had an internet relationship with her for a year, and she kept saying, I'm coming over. And eventually she did come over. By the time she came over, I'd been through all the emotional unloading with my friends and told them that I fell for her, and I'm trying to tell her that I can't really see her, but she still wants to come over anyway, and I can't stop her. And it was all this bullshit going on in my brain about, when she comes over, what am I going to say to her?
I completely fucked myself up when I met her, because I introduced her to a friend of mine who knew her mum before she went back to London, and she fell for him straight away, you know what I mean? And I was just left in this sort of cloud. I was off the hook, but I didn't want to be off the hook. I was thinking, hold on, there could have been something going on there, and I missed it, you know what I mean?
Oh.
So I missed my chance. I just threw the wrong dart.
Yeah, you had a lot of... if you'd encouraged... You did encourage her from day one, or not. You discouraged her.
No, we had a good relationship.
You had...
It was fun.
Yeah.
She was talking to me about everything that she felt, and
you had a major wobbler just before she came.
No, I didn't have a major wobbler. It was
like a prison relationship for you, Terry. I used to have love letters, send them back and forth when I was a kid.
Yeah.
And that's what you were doing, all these love letters, and then
too much love.
When you're engaged, you're just
it's too intense. You just think, wow, this is too much. I can't do this anymore.
You probably didn't meet all those people who said, fucking hell.
I'm sure you're not going to do the same thing again. Right? It's a very unlikely scenario that you would have the same thing, intimate relationship, love letters, and da da da. You'll have a different scenario.
It ain't over.
But what you got.
It ain't over.
I know.
This is the thing. I want to make it to, when I leave here tomorrow, whenever I leave here, it's going to be over.
That's we can do a ceremony
I'm
for
trying
you.
To get rid
I
of
do a very,
trying to get
very
rid of,
interesting
an obsessive, compulsive
okay.
desire.
I can do a very interesting ceremony with you. It only takes about half an hour, and it's called cutting the ties that bind.
To let go of desire.
Yeah. Well, to let go of attachment to the person. You can still have the relationship, but you're letting go of the bondage that keeps you locked into the mental,
the physical,
emotional,
spiritual,
physical.
Yeah, I might be locked into it forever because I have a good relationship with her father and his family.
Yeah, you get locked in it without, because you want to be, not because of your programs that you're running.
Okay.
It's a free lock-in. Lock-in because you want to be. Not because you're forced into it by programs that you've got running, which you can't deal with inside your own body. So when you let go, it's like Jessica's mum had this thing in the doorway of her house. When you came in the door, it says, if you love someone, let them go. If they come back to you, they were meant to be with you. If they weren't, you're free. It was a picture of a swallow. It was like that. It's the freedom we have to give everybody.
Yeah, that's a theory.
No,
that's a belief.
It's not. It's a practical, empirical,
no, listen,
justified, proven.
I've done me Google.
How more can I get them direct than that?
I've done me Google research, right? The only way off one obsessive loop is to get on another obsessive loop and become obsessive about. No, this is the cycle of belief.
Getting the fucking things.
Yeah, but don't go from obsession to obsession.
People do.
Or you go from
loads of people do.
You go
all
from
the
obsession.
Obsessive compulsive.
Yeah, but
then.
I don't think you can get rid of it by pretending it's by trying to ignore it. Pretending it's not there.
No.
Yeah, you see, you can't ignore it, okay?
I didn't say ignore it.
But you can maybe do
create
something.
New pathways.
I think.
New pathways. Yeah, but that's a hairy, fairy, symbolistic kind of where is it?
No, but
thing,
those pathways don't have to be obsessive. This, what I'm talking about, is only that you said, I thought you were saying it about yourself. I go from one obsessive relationship to another obsessive relationship. But what you've learned in this obsessive relationship, you don't have to take to the next one. You don't have to say it's going to be obsessive. What you have to say is it's going to be a co-creative, beautiful, loving, you know, it's not obsessive.
Well,
it's just
good.
Perfect. Whatever your definition of a perfect relationship is.
All right. Well, I'd say...
Hold that as your ideal.
I'd say with your relationship to the Earth, right, you have a
solid...
That's
very important.
You have a solid relationship to the Earth like you have a relationship to anything else.
That's right. And you keep that up all the time by being as close as you can to Earth, air, fire and water.
Yeah.
Fire, you know, drink the well water, breathe the fresh air, and eat the plants from the earth.
Right.
And the closer you get, the closer you live on the earth, if you could actually live right on the earth, which we can't, but a lot of Indian people do, they live right on the earth bare feet. You know, the floors of their huts are mud, compacted mud. They're living right on the earth all the time, spitting onto it, pissing onto it, shitting onto it, living it. you know, they live on the earth,
out,
mate.
I'm going to walk out into the mud, right?
With yeah, do.
Yeah.
Yeah, go on.
If
you want a torch, mate,
to
see the big fuck-off torch there by that vodka bottle? You can take that torch with you.
My feet are going to be covered in mud when I come back.
That's fine, man.
It's a baptism of fire.
There's no mud, actually. There is no mud.
I have to get rid. You know, I have to get rid of this obsession. I have to make. I have
to. Terry, you're running right tomorrow.
I'm going to film my feet going into the mud.
Oh yeah, put Bob down on and whilst you're away, Terry, so we'll have two different things happening. Seriously, put Bob down on the fucking CD player, please.
No, I'm going to film my feet going into the mud. What's this?
He's a good dog. This good man.
Yeah, well,
I've hypnotised him to death.
No. Proactively.
You know, I choose him like that because he doesn't mind.
Yeah.
You don't mind, do you? I treat you pretty bad, don't I, Ray? But you're a fucking... You cheated me so many times, man. Told on me, you bullshit me.
No, I...
Talked about the IRA.
No, I didn't.
Shit, that you were going to get the IRA on me.
I never talked of doing any of your...
Yes, you did. You
no, I didn't. I never went to please.
In the early days, 15 years ago, you were very IRA.
Listen, he was telling me about the hard times he was having at the time. Being
he was in his youth, this man, was a serious IRA sympathiser, weren't you? Admit it.
Yeah.
You were. Why not?
I would be.
The IRA were fighting for freedom of Ireland, basically from British rule. And that's
more than
okay.
Just freedom from the UK. You know, it's not. It's about philosophy of life. I mean, what's happened down here is a disgrace as far as politics.
Disgrace.
Well, now Ireland's going to lead the way.
You are Irish, aren't you?
Yeah, I was born in London, but I got an Irish passport, Irish citizenship.
But you've told the Irish accent.
Well, I moved to Ireland when I was two.
I thought you were Irish, didn't you?
I thought you were
Irish. I was about two when I moved to Omagh, and I lived there
Omagh.
Until I was...
When
I moved to Omagh?
Right.
That's in the north,
yeah?
Yeah,
north.
Omagh,
Tyrone.
I moved
but
there.
You were at school
and
here?
Yeah, I left when I was 18, went to the Christian Brothers Primary and Secondary. It was called... It had just been changed after I went there.
How was that? Did you get abused by them or no?
Yeah, hit the canes, hit without a strap. I was a rascal.
You were in constant state of fear.
No, I was just a bit of a terrorist.
Eddy
Britt.
Yeah.
Look at the tag, Eddy Britt. I had to fight with everybody.
How much of a bitch?
And the dad, I was fucking, what the fuck's this nonsense?
How much of a bitch?
Just fucking, why is everybody so violent?
Bit of a terrorist.
Violence is a fucking serious mental illness.
It is.
The act of violence, you know, and if people can do it cold for somebody else, that's a fucking bad state of affairs.
Very mild, actually. It was the Maudlin sisters, you saw the film. Maudlin Laundry, the Maudlin sisters, the film.
I'm not sure.
About the women were sent to the... schools, like, where they were actually monasteries, but there was huge laundries.
No, shit, you just...
It was called the Magdalen Laundry.
The Magdalen Sisters.
The Magdalen Sisters, that's the film, yeah.
And Phyllis was there.
Have you seen that? Yeah, you
sure.
The Magdalen Sisters.
Do you know Stevie's friend? Oh,
was that the bird? The Irish Republican MP girl?
I didn't see that, no.
That got shot, like... Was that the Irish Sinn Féin MP that got shot?
No, this is about...
Oh my God.
This is about a laundry that was for young girls and how they were...
Young girls that got pregnant were sent to the monasteries.
It's quite a famous...
If I wasn't going to be around, I'd fucking support that monastery major and make sure it was brought up right. Going to raise some funds for it, like. But I wasn't.
It was all the priest raping them.
No, fuck that. They're going to change, you know. I mean, Vatican III, get it through.
They're being exposed big time right now, the Irish Catholic pedophile ring. They're being exposed. Dublin was serious. Every single diocese in Dublin had pedophile priests.
Before I forget, I've got two uncles who are priests. I've declared to both of them that I've cut off a cold who is perceivable in my house, or I'm never going to see again. And a lot of cousins all around, I said, you know, you're not welcome in my house. I don't even want to see my gallery, my art, nothing. You know, I only show by appointment. Otherwise, I'm not selling prints. I don't care about them, you know. But my space is my space, and it took me a long time to establish it. A lot of bullying from the whole family, so. But I'm getting there, you know.
I'm just sorry that the Irish people have taken so long to find out about it.
Yeah, it's fucking nonsense. It's fucking politics.
Because it was being covered up by the parents and the local police and the local judiciary, and everybody was covering up for it.
You know, I tell you what, I spent a fucking 2.5 weeks doing that.
I know TreyBond.com. I know TreyBond.com.
That's been you. I've got a whole new site coming up. It's not launched yet, but.
It's a nice card.
Yeah, man, I've got to represent myself, right?
Can you do websites?
I don't like doing them. I just do my own as a basic sort of portfolio site at the moment, but when I do launch it, the new one.
What I want to find is a Mac man. A Mac guru. Mac.
I'm always been PC because you can do whatever operating system.
Most people aren't.
Yeah.
But Mac people have got a brother. You know, it's a wonderful system, seamless computing.
Yeah.
I absolutely love it.
Yeah. Well,
compared with PC, it's a joy to use.
Well, I grew up with it. I learned in different operating systems.
So what I need is a Mac guru who will put up my website for me.
I could do it in Flash or something, or Adobe, Dreamweaver, stuff like that.
But and what it would work on your Mac once it's set up, I need to be able to go into it and change text and do things without knowing any computer language, HTML or anything. I just want to be able to type in what I want.
I said to you last year, man, get pieces of A4 and just sketch it out.
I've done it all, I've got it all. I've got every page.
I've
done most of it. I've got almost every page that I want up. It's all there.
Information flowchart, you get your home page, the top circle.
Yeah, I've got all that.
Done, and you've got your sub-menus,
sub-menus, drop-down menus, everything. I've got every page. I've done all the content of most of the pages. And I've got the whole thing sorted exactly what I want.
Cool.
The website.
Once you get it up there, the concept, someone else will come in and help you. It won't be me.
No.
But somebody else will.
How do I find a Mac expert? In, say, where I'm living in Scotland with Jesse, up in Inverness.
Personal recommendation, and I don't have
one. Yeah, but
you know,
there's so little people that use Mac.
Do you know somebody who does is Jenny's brother?
He's a Mac.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, he might know something.
He knows the Mac.
So probably by asking
him. He'd be the right person.
Yeah, that'd
be great. Okay.
He lives near,
If there was somebody like...
Arse.
Right. If there was somebody in the area that I could visit once a month.
He might know someone.
Because normally, say... Alex Jones, you know, he has a studio. He's doing a radio show, but he has a studio.
Yeah.
And in the studio, there's like two computer people, and they're absolute experts on computers.
Yeah, you need somebody that knows.
But I'd like to have that at a very minor level, so there was a total expert that could go once a week, update everything I want to do, find out how to do things I can't do.
Is there any alternative press? Is there any like alternative press for this part of Ireland, like hot press or something like that, on a more rural area?
I'm not going to be here. I'm going to be in northern Scotland.
Yeah, all right.
You'll have to come and visit me up there, man.
I'd love it. Yeah.
Yeah, you would. Where she lives, I'm
going
to live.
Van full of treats,
I'm going to live where Jessie lives.
Oh man.
And she has a cabin, a wooden log cabin, in a birch forest, on the edge of an oak forest, on the edge of a bog, at the bottom of one of the highest mountains in the whole area, looking down on Loch Ness.
Mm-hmm.
And it's absolutely awesome piece of ground, mm-hmm. isn't it?
I thought
totally ancient, totally ancient mixed woodland.
That's Terry being naughty, like.
It's ancient mixed woodland.
Uh-huh.
Basically oak, with everything else in there.
Mm.
You know, it's got all the indigenous. It's indigenous. Yeah. You know. Beautiful. Some of the oak trees are really big.
Yeah,
it must be 300-year-old oaks.
The closest thing I got is like Gordon Glen's. It's like fir trees, Christmas trees, big Christmas trees. So when you go in there, it's just firs
Scots
everywhere,
pines.
And you look up and you get all fucking fractals everywhere. I did a load of pictures
Scots
on it.
Scots pines.
So like I've seen it with Darcy and Pollock.
Oh,
you
right, know, yeah,
so.
Yeah.
Scots pines are amazing for that, man. They are every Scots pine, when you go up, it loses all its branches as it grows. Have you noticed
right,
that?
Yeah, yeah.
They have no lower branches.
They
grow
up,
and they
yeah.
go up and up and up. And then they form into these amazing sort of structural, architectural masterpieces, actually.
Yeah,
every one is individual.
Yeah,
and they've got
some,
these wonderful branches.
Yeah.
Yeah. And on the floor...
I'm up. You found it, Jerry.
I'm up.
Woodbine.
Smoking
woodbine.
I'm on my way.
Both these cameras work. I'm on a split screen at the moment. Now Terry's on screen and ours.
That was nice.
No, I'm ready for the ritual.
Yeah, I was.
My feet made the connection to the earth. I watched.
Cool. All right.
My feet went into the
puddle. Part two. Here we go.
That's right.
And then the mud and squeezed
went barefoot. I know you did. You took my advice. You went.
And
barefoot.
It hurt as well. It hurt.
No, it didn't hurt. No.
It was a baptism of fire.
Discomfort.
No, it hurt on the way down. Do you know what? It didn't hurt on the way up though.
Where's the coat, Terry? The coat. Coat in the door. Yeah. Pull the coat out.
Again. Oh, it's gone out.
You know why that door opened?
Yeah,
that was
open.
The spirit entering the room.
Yeah.
That's the spirit entering the room. The spirit's saying, I want to listen to this. Come on.
I'm all right. You're keeping them out with our smoke signals, like, upstairs. Like, chug, 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 chug.
This is a real shaman ritual. This is a sacred moment. Magic is going to do his magic. By expelling a demon from my brain.
One? Only one?
One at a time.
What about all the other ones?
I don't know how many there are in there, for fuck's sake.
Start with one. Which is the worst one?
Fear and loathing.
What's the one that bothers you the most? What's this one do to you?
Fear and loathing in Las Vegas.
No, fear and loathing inside your own body, yeah? You don't think you're good enough.
Obviously.
Obviously.
That's one big fat spliff there.
You're
look at
not
that.
Good enough, Terry. You're not fucking
good
enough.
Good enough.
Give me
worthy. Worthy is
worthy
the word I use.
Love.
Worthiness, yes.
You're lacking in self-worth.
Yeah.
Understandable.
Yeah.
If I was in your body, I'd probably do the same.
You probably would.
No, I'd be horrible.
You lucky.
No, you're being honest. There's a difference.
No, I'm not being honest. I'm joking.
You can be as honest as you like. You
I
can
am,
be as cruel
honest,
as you like.
Right?
Don't
no,
worry
I'm not
about
being
it.
Cruel either. What I'm saying is that it's understandable. All understandable. To be disappointed in love and to have unrequited love in your life is a very tricky thing to deal with. I've had it several times and I don't like it.
Oh no, it's
basically I avoid it.
It's requited.
I want,
it's requited.
I want no more unrequited love in my life. Thank you very much.
It's requited, but it's not appropriate.
It's not what?
It's not appropriate. No, I have to be aware of appropriation.
Appropriation? That's different from appropriateness. Appropriation is taking somebody else's property. That's not
No, well, that's the same thing.
Everybody, what's going on over here? Look at this. And again.
That's a big fat split, man. Fear and loathing in Las Vegas.
Help me through my
war. The flash murder scene.
Oh, man.
Disappearing into
Scotland.
That does look like a fucking prophecy.
Hey, have you seen this YouTube video, man? This is so good. If you type in, marijuana journalist on fire. Have you seen
that long sentence?
Marijuana.
big.
Marijuana burning bitch. Marijuana burning.
How do you spell it again? I'm not sure.
Oh, God. Marijuana.
M-A-R-A-G-U-A-N-A.
J-U-N-A.
J-U-N-A. Yes. Marijuana.
J. Right. J-U-A-N-A. Marijuana. Is that right? Put the... Because it's telling you made a spelling mistake, so take that as something. I'll do it for you. Press control.
No, it's it's a Spanish-based word, so it's got H.
It's got an H in it somewhere.
Yeah,
Yeah, wait a minute, we got it. We just put the cursor on it, we put that there, and we press that. And it goes to marijuana.
Yeah, I've got an H in it.
So it's marijuana, and then the next word is burning.
Some kind of reward, as behind me the soldiers gather and burn huge piles of coca leaves and marijuana. The drug barons themselves may have escaped the meth this time, but their evil wares have not. And I think you better cut that. Behind me, smoke, soldiers burning drugs. There, soldiers, behind me, soldiers, rugged soldiers, sons of Wales, burning drugs. Painstakingly. Behind me, painstaking barons burning lead drug soldiers in huge piles of whale nets. Oh, that's the one, Jerry. Hey! Let's go for it.
That's a good one. I'm going to book.